Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for all you brought us thus far in the workers' retreat. We praise your name because you have spoken to our hearts. And as we round up now, Lord, we pray that you still speak to us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We pray that you will lead us into victory.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Marching forward to conquer. Marching forward to conquer. In Numbers chapter 10, from verse 29, and Moses said unto Hobab, the son of Reguel, the Midianite, Moses' father-in-law, we are journeying unto the place of which the Lord said, I will give it you. Come thou with us, and we will do thee good, for the Lord has spoken good concerning Israel. Here Moses extended the great invitation to this man that he had known. Not only that he had known him, they had worked together. While Moses was still outside the land of Egypt, for those 40 years, this was the man that he lived with, until Moses received in a fresh way the call of God upon his life. And he told this man, Hobab, or called Jethro, just another name for the same man, his father-in-law, that the Lord had called him. He knew the call before. He felt the call before. But because he wasn't quite ready, and it wasn't quite God's time to fulfill that call, and he didn't have the Spirit of God, the wisdom of God, and the guidance of God, he had gone his own way, and he did what he shouldn't have done at the time he shouldn't have done it. And eventually, he came to Hobab, and he said the Lord had now given him a fresh call. And Hobab blessed him and sent him away. Many things had happened in Egypt, and they had come out of the land of Egypt. There were thousands of men, adult men, that followed after him, as well as thousands of women, as well as children. They numbered all together into millions. While he was in the wilderness, on the way to the land of Canaan, this man, Hobab, the son of Reguel, Moses' father-in-law, came to meet him. He had given him advice, even concerning the work, and Moses had prayed and known that the advice was really God sent. But now he said, instead of staying beside the camp, outside the camp, and just giving us advice, giving us instruction, giving us guidance, why not join the team? Because we are journeying unto the place of the which the Lord said, I will give it you. Moses had a sense of mission, an understanding of destiny, and a vision for progress and success. You see, in many people's lives, there is no sense of destiny. They are here today, and they feel they may not be here tomorrow. So let us eat and drink. We do not know what will happen tomorrow. No planning, no direction, no where that they are going. They just know that today they are alive. As to what will happen tomorrow, they have no idea. They do not believe that when God made them, that he made them for a purpose. God is not like human beings. They bring forth children into this world. They never have any plan. Do they ever have anything to take care of the children? Do they have any plan to direct and lead the children? They don't know. They just know that other families have children. Let us have children. But God is not like that. When he made you for a purpose. He had something in your life that must be accomplished. And if the 100% totality of that thing is not established and not accomplished before you die or before Jesus comes, you have a lot of questions to answer. that God made you the person he made you. He brought you into the church that he planned for you. And he also planned for your life that this is what will accomplish for him and his kingdom in that church and through that church. That will not be like a bird flying over, never making a path or a mark in the path that he passes through. That God made you for a very definite purpose, and you should have a sense of mission. Do you know that Jesus had a sense of mission? He said, "For this purpose was I born." They said, "Are you a king?" He said, "Yes. This is the very reason I am here. And my kingdom is not of this world." And even after crucifixion and burial, the kingdom has not ended. That the power, the authority of the kingdom, you will still see, because it's an everlasting kingdom. And whatever happens now is just one of the milestones leading me to the point that God had ordained for me. He had a sense of mission. Paul the Apostle, he also had a sense of mission. He knew that he was made for something. He said, "God, who separated me from my mother's womb, he had so ordained that he will place me in the ministry." He said, "Naturally, I'm not qualified to be called an apostle, but I am who I am. I am what I am by the grace of God." And he said, "I will not frustrate the grace of God." He has a plan. He has a purpose. He has called me. I have a sense of mission. The apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ, from the time they heard the word of the Lord, "Follow me, I will make you fishers of men," they had a sense of mission. Since you were born, did you ever have a sense of mission? You see, the people that get fed up with life, so many difficulties, so many trials, so many shortcomings, so many hindrances in their ways, and they end up their lives, there's no sense of mission. They do not believe that after crucifixion, a resurrection will come. They do not believe after the sowing, a reaping will come. They do not believe after the dawn, when it is very dark, the morning will come. They do not believe that after the rain and the flood, a time of sunshine will come. Neither do they believe that they will soon pass through this night of affliction and the day of progress will come on. Because of that, all they can see is the darkness, the difficulty, the problem. And since there is no purpose now for living, no sense of mission, they just die. They just give up the ghost before the time. And the plan of God for their lives is cut short. But Moses said, "We are journeying. We left Egypt, and we know we are going somewhere." Since you left the world, do you know you are going somewhere? Do you have a place before you? And do you have the shining light guiding you? Is the Holy Spirit within you telling you, "Don't rest yet, don't sit down yet, don't relax yet"? The place you are going, you have not got there yet. But Moses had that sense of mission. And then he knew there was a sense of destiny. Only one life, but it's meant for something. Now sometimes you feel that life is short, that time is short. And you say, "We do not have enough time. Oh, if I had enough time, I will do a lot." Jesus had only 3.5 years. And at the end of 3.5 years, he said, "I have finished what you told me to do." Paul the Apostle had just a few years. At the end of those few lives, he said, "Now I've finished the course. I've run the race." And the apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ, they had, some of them had just about 30 years. Those who are converted at the age of 30, at the age of 35, among them, John was the youngest and was converted just below 30. And you know that many of those people were killed, and therefore they couldn't spend all the time. But before Peter left, Peter wrote his epistle and said, "The Lord has shown me that I must put off this tabernacle. Now I'm rounding up. The only thing that remains for me to do is to stir up your pure minds." Those people knew that they had something to do. and they were about finishing it. Some people do not even know whether they have started or they have not started. What does God have for them to do? They don't know. Why are they here now? They don't know. How unfortunate it would be if you came only to this workers' retreat, because they made announcement and they said, there is workers' retreat for our district at this time, and I happen to be in the district, but no sense of mission. Not that I have an appointment with Almighty God, and God is going to give fuel to the vehicle that has been running the race that is sent before me. He's put destination or destiny before me, and he wants me to have some fuel, some power, some anointing, some insight, so that I can keep on in the journey that he raised me up for. Moses said, we are journeying unto the place of the which the Lord said, I will give it you. You see, in life, if we do not have a sense of mission, many things will be upside down. For those of us who are married, do you believe that God led you into that marriage because there is a sense of mission? You know, in marriage, difficulties will come. Sometimes the difficulties will be near crucifixion. Your mother-in-law would almost crucify you. Your father-in-law would almost crucify you. The uncles and the cousins of your husband will almost crucify you. Almost all the villagers might be crying out because you're not doing the things that they're doing in that village. They might all be crying, crucify her. And because of the cry of crucifixion, you don't think there's any destiny, any sense of mission in that family. And because of that thing that is tending towards crucifixion and persecution, you say, let me give up. Let me pack up. Now, if you pack up and you leave that family, what was the purpose of God originally for allowing that marriage? Has it been fulfilled? Well, I don't know. Why don't you stay there then? They are almost crucifying me. That will just be the gateway to the fulfillment of God's purpose. It may be the man. The man has got married. And this man is having hell on earth with the wife. And it is very, very difficult. And the wife is making life difficult. The parents of the woman, they are making life difficult. All these years, yet no child. All these years, look at what our daughter is still wearing. So, since you married this, our daughter, she doesn't have 2, 3, 5 boxes of up-to-date type of dresses. Not this type of dress that you wear to church. Up-to-date, that can be used for this ceremony. You know that in our own place, when you have burial ceremony, there is a type of outing that our daughter ought to have. Because we are not ordinary people, background people in our village. And since this daughter, we have given this daughter, so you think that after paying dowry, everything has been, that is all? You don't spend for our daughter again because of all that trouble they are making. Then your wife also will be saying, you heard what mommy said. But I take you to Gbagada every Sunday. So because you take me to Gbagada every Sunday, I should not listen to my mother again. And you say, well, maybe I will drive out this woman so that I can do the work of God. But that woman is the work of God. That's a soul there to save. That's a soul there to revive. Living, if you fail there, you fail in every other part of the ministry. You cannot win the sinner, the soul, living, sleeping on the same bed with you. You cannot pray and get that person right into the kingdom of God. That's failure. No matter what you do outside, you have lost the soul that is nearest unto you. How about why God gave that woman to you? Why God permitted that woman to be your wife? A sense of destiny. We are journeying somewhere. Between you and your wife. Between you and your husband. You say, my wife is always complaining. Well, that's work for you to do. You have a work to do on your wife. There is an assignment given to you in that home. But when there is no sense of destiny, we'll be saying, I'm packing my load. Where are you packing to? I'm packing somewhere. You are going where it's not the will of God for you. Outside your home, that's not the will of God. Anything you do there is wasted time, wasted effort. Because where God has given you a sense of destiny, a purpose to live, you pack out of that place. You say, the trouble is so much. What if Jesus Christ had said, the talk of the Sadducees or the Pharisees, so too much for me. I'm going back to heaven. I'm going to live with my father. I pity those women that say they have family problem and they cannot stay there and solve the problem. They say, I'm going back to my mother. Every extra day you spend there with your father, with your mother, you are outside the will of God. And you won't fulfill the purpose of God for your life. But you remain there. You say, there is a sense of destiny. I have something to do here. You know, I pity some workers. They do not have a sense of destiny. They just know that I am in deeper life. But where in deeper life? Where? Because God wants you to be in a specific place in deeper life. And here is where you are now. Look at your district. Look at your zone. And look at your area. Look at your house fellowship. Or look at all the women. Oh, you see, those people, the area where I am, they are the backward people. I am moving out of that place. If that is not the directive of the Lord for you, if that is not the spirit of the Lord for you, leading you out of the backward area to go to where you think that one is better, you are out of the will of God. Because God has given you that place purposefully, so that you will accomplish what other people cannot accomplish. When God raised up Paul the apostle, he didn't raise him up for Jerusalem. He raised up other people for Jerusalem. Once in a while, when Jerusalem got any trouble and he needed to raise offering for them, he will give the offering to them. He'll go back to where God raised him for. He said, I am raised up a teacher to the Gentiles. I magnify my office. And he said, when they saw the grace of God on me, they told me that they will go to the Jews, the Jerusalem people, but I and Barnabas should go to the Gentiles. They knew that that's his ministry. Do you know your ministry? That's how we're running about. I don't think that this zone is okay for me. Why did God place you there? You know, when you were very young and you saw that your daddy was hard, difficult, and you looked at another family, you were saying, I think I would have been of that family. You didn't like your father. You didn't like home. Anytime you were coming back from school, you know, you remember, when I get home now, that man, this is what he will do. But God did not make a mistake. That he made you to be born in that place. Or you think that God is not concerned about that. People are just born anywhere. God doesn't care about background. God doesn't care about your marriage. God doesn't care about anything that you do at all. Of course, you know, if you know the Bible, he cares. Before we were ever born again, he loved us before we ever loved him. Or do you think that it was the first time you began praying for salvation that God suddenly knew that person is one of my creatures in the world? No, God knew all along. And he had been directing you, until now you come to his will. Look at all the problems that Moses had with the children of Israel. Sometimes they will say they will stone him. At other times they will so grumble and complain that they will be wondering, what type of people are these? Sometimes he and Aaron will fall down before the Lord on their faces saying, oh Lord, how do we deal with these people? And yet, there was a sense of destiny. And the thing we need to learn today is that in your own family, in your marriage, there should be a sense of destiny. In the work you're doing, in the zone, in the district, in the area, in the house fellowship, whatever it is you are doing with the children, there should be a sense of mission and a sense of destiny. And then Moses knew that there is progress, and there is going to be progress. The Lord had said, I will give it you. Come down with us. We will do you good. Come down with us. Well, we don't know what we can do for you. But come with us in any case. You know, that's the attitude of some people. Well, come with us, neighbor. We hope that you'll be blessed. But I hope I could promise you that you will see the pastor, but we don't know yet. I myself, a leader there, I've not seen the pastor now for, I only see him afar off, not like before, when we can just, you know, go to him and say, Bro, how are you? Good afternoon. I have a problem like this. No card, nothing. But neighbor, come down with us. I don't know whether you will get anything, but come. You may be lucky. No sense of mission. No positive contribution. Come down with us. We will do you good. What didn't Moses begin to tell this man and begin to say? Well, sometimes we don't have water to drink in the wilderness. But in any case, come down with us. Don't let that discourage you. And sometimes too, the manna that we have been eating, the same type of meal we have been eating every day for so many years now. But don't let that discourage you. Come down with us and you will eat the manna too. Sometimes they complain about the manna. It's not good enough. But come down with us. And those of us in the leadership, myself and Aaron and and the other people, sometimes we're almost losing our lives because the people will think of stoning us when they get discouraged. But don't let that shake you. Come down with us. That's not the way that Moses mentioned it. He said, come down with us, we will do you good. Not that they will do you good. I am part of the people that will bring goodness in your life as you come with us. Do you see yourself as part of the winning team? As part of the people that can do good unto people? Or do you just say, well, my work is not important there. They made me house fellowship leader. But what is house fellowship in a large church like that? The church is very large. Whether I do well or I don't do well, they are church, will continue. Well, I'm just a woman. And they just want to encourage us, just they say do this and do that and do that. But well, heaven knows and I know that whether we do well or we don't do well, their church will continue. All that I'm doing there is that they say that in that remote place, that area where there is no tarred road, and anytime it rains, the people cannot come to church. We even stand waiting for bus, we cannot see bus, and we go back home. Whether we get to their church or we don't get to their church, church carries on. But, I will keep on doing what they want me to do, since, after all, it's good to keep on doing something, just to know that you are a worker in the church. But whether I contribute or I don't contribute my part, their church will continue. Is that how you feel? There are people that feel like that. And they feel they are not important. They are not essential. The church can do without them. The work can go on without them. After all, if I die, won't they continue? Yes, we will continue. But remember, when believers die, it's because they have finished their course. While you're still alive and you have not finished your course, the church cannot do without you. And God cannot do without you. But some people say, after all, Paul died and didn't the church continue? Yes, that's after Paul had finished his course. Peter died. Didn't the church continue? Oh, yes. After Peter had finished his work. Even Moses, didn't he die? Oh, yes, he died. But how could he have died before they wrote Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy? Suppose he had died and no record of all those things. He died only after he had finished his work. Have a sense of mission. Have a sense of destiny. And understand that while you're still alive, God has something for you. We will do you good. For the Lord has spoken good concerning Israel. He had faith. He believed that thing that the Lord had spoken, the Lord will definitely do it. And we thank the Lord because of the promises he has given to us. We thank him because he's given us general promises in the Bible that he has given to every church. Not only deeper life. But apart from that, we have specific promises. Every time you meet somebody that says that nobody invited him to deeper life, and I meet them almost every time, and they would say that they were just praying, and they were saying, oh Lord, I want to worship you. I'm not satisfied with where I am. Can you lead me to a place? And God will give them the name of this church and describe the place to them. And have you ever had any testimony like that before? Yes. Now, why is God doing that if there is no purpose for a church like this? If God does not have any record of a church like this, you don't talk about somebody you don't have a record about. God will not be directing people. I mean, even Muslims. A Muslim was talking to me, and he said, all the religion, when he followed after that religion, he became fed up. And he started asking God, I know you are there, but isn't there a better way to worship you? And God, in his love and kindness, he directed that person and mentioned deeper life. The fellow said she had never had anything like that before. And eventually was searching and then came out. When she came out, she saw a lot of people, I think at Oshodi, and they were carrying Bibles. And then she followed in the bus. And then when they got near the church, he said, I'm asking of deeper life. And they pointed and said, see, that's deeper life. Look at their signboard there. And the moment she came in, she knew that this is a place. And since that time, she had never missed any meeting. Aren't you happy that God has a record of the place he has placed you? And he has told you, do you know, I received a card from a far away place, not even in Nigeria, not even West Africa. And it's a place we have not sent a single missionary from Lagos here. It's a place we have not directly even sent our tracts. A checkup over here. We've not even posted any track there. We've never sent any missionary from Nigeria. And I received that card. Many, many people signed that card, but it's a single card. And they wrote Deeper Life Bible Church. And they mentioned the city. They mentioned the place. And I've been looking for it on the map. I've not even seen it on the map. Just the address and that card. And many, many people. And they said Deeper Life Bible Church. And then they wrote to me as their leader. I've never seen them. I've never known them. We've never sent anything there. We've never sent any missionary there. How can you be in a church like that and not have sense of mission? That God has called you here and you must do something. There's a record in heaven that God brought you here and there's something God wants you to do. And we all together, we are journeying onto the place where the Lord himself has directed us. And I believe that you will not fail.
Amen.
Any grace, any strength that you need, I believe God will grant unto you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
But you know this man? He didn't follow. And there were reasons why he couldn't follow. He couldn't march on to victory. Let's look at verse 30. And he said unto them, I will not go. But I will depart to mine own land and to mine own kindred. If you are too much attached to your people in the world, your relatives, natural men and women, you may miss the purpose of God for your life. The man said, Moses, I hear what you have said. I see the mighty army that is going on. And I see that God has been good unto you. I have no doubt in my heart, if I followed you, I will benefit as we go together. But I cannot go. And I will not go. I will depart to my own land, to my own kindred. Are the people of the world pulling you back? Are the demands of the world so high, so great upon you? Are your business partners pulling you back, drawing you back? Are your relatives, natural relatives, drawing you back? That you cannot march on to conquer. And you cannot say, I have a life to live. Only one life, but it will be significant for the kingdom of God. He said, I cannot go. The traditions of our land, the culture of our land, they are too strong on me and they are calling me back. My old friends, I'm too much attached to them. And my old relatives, I remember what we have done together, what we have said together, what we have planned together. And even though this is a call coming from heaven, I cannot go, I will not go. I will go back to my own land. But is that your land greater, better than the land of Canaan, where the milk and the honey are flowing, where God himself will be sending rain, where it will be like heaven on earth, where it will be another, a replica, so to say, of the Garden of Eden, the Garden of God, where God will show and manifest his presence and his power every time? Come. Don't go back. Let us move on, because there is a destiny awaiting us. In verse 31, and he said, leave us not, I pray thee. Moses pleaded with him. He said, leave us not, I pray thee, for as much as thou knowest how we are to encamp in the wilderness, and thou mayest be to us instead of eyes. You have some qualities, eyes to see what we cannot see. You have heart to understand what we cannot understand. You are a guide. You are a leader. God has raised you up, a guide and a leader. And we need your eyes to see and show us the way while we're journeying in the wilderness. God has placed you as an important member of the body. Eyes, some of us are feet, some of us are hands, some of us are other parts of the body, but you have this indispensable ministry of being eyes to the millions and to the multitude. Don't go back. Leave us not. For as much as you know how that we are to encamp in the wilderness, and thou mayest be instead of eyes unto us. And it shall be, if thou go with us, yea, it shall be that what goodness the Lord shall do unto us, the same we will do unto thee. Brothers and sisters, it shall be when we get to heaven, that all the deeper life as a body, as a church, united together, all that we have done, there will be reward, but all the reward will be divided towards everybody, to everybody that has contributed into the movement and into the goal, into the kingdom of God, into the part of the kingdom that deeper life has been able to establish. It shall be that whatever goodness, whatever reward God will give to us as a body, we'll share it together. Think about the joy and think about what God is doing. We know that there are other churches. We know there are other assemblies. But look at the progress they are making. And if God is going to go by the work that is done, and he will go by that, because they that lead many to righteousness shall shine as stars in the firmament of heaven. And as God will go by the fruitfulness, by the productivity, by the result of what God has done through that local body, that the reward will be commensurate to the work that has been done. Look at the things that are going on all over this land, all over this nation. Be part of this body. Sink all that you have. Give all that you have, all your energy, all your strength, all your ability. Put everything together and let us work for the Lord, because there is a reward awaiting us. And the man did not answer anymore. He wasn't willing. But we are willing. And I know that we are able. Because the Lord will soon come. Whatever we can do, let us do for the name of our God. For the glory of our God. He has given us the great commission. Go preach the gospel to every creature. And by the grace of God, we're going to do it. In Numbers chapter 13, verse 30. And Caleb stilled the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. I think I can speak for every one of us here this afternoon. We are well able. Amen. We can possess the land. Amen. We can do the will of the Lord. Amen. My exhortation to you this afternoon is, let us go up at once. Don't let us waste any time. The ministry, the work, everything is waiting for every one of us. As we go back to the zones, as we go back to the areas, as we go back to our house fellowship and to our various communities, let us serve the Lord our God. If you have been giving time to God, give more time. You've been giving money to the Lord, give more money. You've been giving your compassion, your sympathy, caring for the people, give more. Do more. You've been laboring for the Lord. You've been preaching the gospel, preach more. You've been praying for people and delivering them, pray more. Because the reward will be great when we get to heaven. God is not unfaithful to forget your good works that you have done in laboring for the kingdom of God. But don't let us look back. Don't let us get tired. Difficulties may come. Even something that looks like crucifixion may come our way. But thank God, crucifixion is not the end of the life of the believer. Resurrection morning will come after. Difficulties, trials, temptations, things that look like problems may come, but that will not be the last sentence in your race. or the last sentence in your life, the glory of God, the power of God, the commendation of God will be the last thing. So let us arise and do the work. Let's rise up and tell the Lord, we are marching on to victory. We will not look back. We will not allow discouragement. We will not allow relatives to pull us back. We will not allow temptations and trial to draw us back. We are going to serve the Lord.
Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this short exhortation. Thank you for opening our eyes to see the life of this Moses. That years after you have given a ministry to him, every time it was still fresh in his mind. He knew the purpose for which you had called him, and he was staying by that purpose up till the end of his life. We ask you that you will use every one of us for your own purpose.
Because God has been so faithful to me. I'm going to keep this very short. First of all, I want to thank God for the church. The church has been my family. Thank you so much, Pastor Dada. He has been a father to me. I don't start crying. Okay, I remember I came here without scholarship to Harvard University. The first year wasn't easy, but I got a grant that paid half of my tuition. But then from second year, I got like 5 different scholarships from my department. And I thank God because I'll be graduating in May. I didn't have to stay out of the room. I just thank God for all his provision. I just bless the name of God.